Beatitudes, Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, Jesus teaches, "How happy are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven." So basically, since we've been here in India, we've been visiting various places like Calicut, which is Mother Teresa's home for the destitute and dying, orphanages. We went to Tipigar, we went to Shantanagar, and we've visited a couple of nurseries and schools, and we've been able to teach the kids. And it's been very, very worthwhile since we've been here, I think. So I'm going to hand you over to David now, who's going to talk about our shadowing experience. So David, if you wouldn't mind. Shadowing experience.
Oh, it's a shadowing experience. Sorry about that, guys. Parents are muffled. But it was day on Tuesday, we were shadowing some young lads from Kolkata, our own age. We got up pretty early. They arrived at, say, 9 o'clock. There was a couple of them, there was Michael, Peter, Johnny, Asir Khan, and they brought us around the city of Kolkata and showed us their homes and their city from their perspective. It wasn't like a tourist, it was just, you know, you saw the streets, you saw the apartment, you saw everything. And we were still in the groups initially, and we were assigned Asir Khan and some other young fellas, and they brought us to the streets, and they just showed us different places. And along the way you saw poverty, you saw people lying in the streets, just sleeping with blankets over their heads, and it was 9 o'clock in the morning, there was kids running around, absolutely nothing. It was kind of a mixture of emotions. It brought us to Shelter Station, not inside the covert, but it was a small thing for them. And all the while they were trapped and caught with them, and they couldn't leave, you know, 16, because they were on foot. We thought we were 35. But, they showed us around the place. Like, it was in the valley. It's their big festival. It's Halloween now, but they have this big festival in the valley. It's huge once for the whole week. Fireworks, everything going off. And after Shelter Station, we was outside. And those guys banging away in drums. It's just madness. And there's people going by crates of chickens in the back of vans and stuff. And just rat poison drumming in the streets. It's not like Limerick at all. From there, we met up with the other groups, and we just got introduced to the other young lads. It's amazing how similar they are to us. They're just same sense of humour, but they come from a totally different culture. So from there, we got on the bus, and the buses are not the buses, they're 40 odd years old, and just like boxing wheels. Without the young fellas, we were lost. They knew everything, tricks of trade. They got us into the bus. And from there, we had a good bus journey, I'd say. And we got to the Ganges. we were talking to the guys in the bus, and, you know, they were taking our hats and stuff and just messing around. And it was kind of a contrast before that they were kind of down, you know, just compressed. So you see people who absolutely nothing, you see the extreme poverty. Then these guys kind of brighten your mood. And then we got off the bus anyway. We went to buy them drinks at the stall and they wouldn't accept it. They didn't want to take it, they wanted to share one between them. And then, so we were sitting on it, we have one, but they were so modest, they didn't want us to pay for them, you know. They think that you know, they don't have much, but they have an awful lot of pride over there. There we got a small boat, a ferry boat, up to the Ganges. I'd say maybe a mile or two. Some experience because you're on their safe river and you're looking out the shore banks and there's people washing their clothes, washing themselves, and it's the sacred river, but it's just full of twigs and dirt and rubbish. It's not very clean. And you got to see Calcutta from the river, and it's amazing. The amount of people there, it's unbelievably crowded. We got off the boat anyway, a little further up, and we walked through these unbelievably busy markets, even the young guys were doing that hands and they were crowded. We had to move across the side of the streets. The traffic is chaotic. They're walking on the side of the roads, you know, footpaths in some places. Instead of using brakes, the cars use horns and jump out of their way. They don't follow any traffic laws and traffic rules. You know, it's very easy to get knocked down over there if you didn't know what you're doing. From there we went over to Howard Bridge. David's going to tell you about this.
I've been asked to talk about Howard's Bridge. It's both one of the seven wonders of the world and the largest commuting part of the world. Truly, it was terrifying going across it. I believe it was a terrifying experience, but I think it was really good for the group. Over the last few days, we've been exposed to the extremities of poverty, disease, and injury in several places. But going over Howard's Bridge was one of the first times we were exposed to all three. The amount of people on it was unbelievable. It was one thing to see it in the ferry, like it was this great feat of mankind, but on top of the bridge it was a completely different story. Thousands of people were rushing against us in both directions. Without the lads teaching us like that, we could have been mowed down easily. The poverty on it was just, it was disgraceful. I think it was the worst poverty that we've seen since we've come. The poverty, it's just ridiculous. The housing that was underneath the bridge, it was worse than sheds. It was falling apart and everything. A lot of people from the houses that came out, there's these type of toilets and everything alongside the roads. They didn't even bother to use them, even though they're only a few feet away. Their dignity has been completely eroded over the last few years of poverty. Several people have literally they urinated in the streets, like they didn't care. You saw other people who were selling several products and jewellery, etc. It's crazy, like none of them were ever going to make a living off it. Many of the people there, I doubt they sold anything, even thinking about the thousands of people, there'd be rows of 10 in a row. Maybe only 3 would sell anything during the day. There was other people that were begging even on Howard Bridge. The form fees were in abundance, to be honest. Men were walking around without feet. There was one man actually who passed inside the road, who was covered over in a bag as if he was sleeping, but to be honest, it was a corpse, I'm not going to lie. Another woman, I was walking down with the group down inside the road on our return journey. She threw herself down in front of thousands of people, just threw herself on the floor. It was disgraceful. It was the first beggar. She threw herself in front of me begging for money. I don't know what I really thought of it. But to be honest, it was absolutely terrifying in a lot of respects. A lot of lads got a bit emotional over it. I've never seen poverty like it before. I think in the other places we've been to, there's been some hope for some of them. They've had a chance to kind of
rehabilitate themselves, get better, and get back into their normal lives, even if they do end up back in some of the hostels or in one of Teresa's homes. But these people on the street, they were never going to get out of there. It was just, there was too many people. The people were washing themselves in the Ganges. The amount of rubbish, it was nauseating, to be honest. The amount of people we passed, they had a type of respect, I suppose, is the word for foreigners. We're completely different to them in every way. Like, we were walking, kind of avoiding a lot of things that were on the road, like that animals might have left behind or whatever. But these people, a lot of them just walked straight through it. They didn't care what happened to them. These people, I don't believe I've ever seen anyone that had a harder life. I have to say, it was very hard hitting for everyone. Kind of shocked to the core. And once we got off the bridge, it was truly a big relief. Like, I didn't know if we could stay on it much longer. I don't actually think we could go back again, like, since we didn't know what to see. The boys we were with were very, they're in the depths of poverty. Like, we visited some of their homes, as John said, but the rooms, they're like boxes, literally. It was crazy to think entire families were living within a few meters square. But the amount of, stubbornness, I'm not sure of the word, but they graded themselves a lot higher than everyone else they saw, which is great in one respect, thinking that they're not completely hopeless themselves, but they were almost arrogant, I suppose. The people in the street, they really had nowhere to go. Like, there was one man who had a baby in his arms, which was odd enough to see, considering most of them were women who had been maybe abandoned or thrown out, but this man literally had nothing. His baby was barely alive, like he was wailing on the side of the street. There was hardly any flesh at all. I thought the skin, he was very pale for an Asian, like it was as if you could nearly see bones coming through his skin in him. It was the most terrifying experience I've ever seen in my life. None of the lads tried to avert their eyes from a lot of things. The boys that we were with that were leading us around, they really took charge and took us through. Like, they didn't let us stop too many times, and when they did, like, it really hit us that we were in the depths of poverty, third world. I don't know if I'll be able to experience it again, but that's all there is to say, really.
We went back to Azarkan's house, and he brought us through these winding, twisting alleys until we came to a door inside the building. Street was about 3 meters wide, so it was a very, very narrow point of view. And we went inside and told us his house was upstairs. So we went in, it's like going to somebody's house, and we go up the stairs, and you go up onto a landing, and it's all dark, and there's just dressers and clothes all over the place, and it's like something out of a medieval movie scene, like ancient Jerusalem or something. That was kind of his family's complex, just upstairs. His family's house, his room where he stayed with his father and mother and his siblings, was on the far side of the landing. There was one room. When he went in, and they all got up off the bed, they had one big old-fashioned bed, but that holiday set. And they all jumped up off the bed, John and we were introduced and said hello. And they wanted us to sit down in the bed, and we said, no, we're grand. But they insisted, no. It was their honour to have us in their house, and they were delighted to have us there. And we sat down in the bed, and they had a TV up in the cupboard, and they had a chest of drawers, and it closed all over the place. It was their whole place, just a single room. And so friendly about them. I mean, back at home, didn't even know us. It was just you know, I went to Bishop Brother School. I mean, you hardly bring some strangers into your house from India or Pakistan. You just show them upstairs to your house and show them where you live. You know? It's amazing. But Askhan's mother gave the money to go out against one Pepsi and these people panting. she gave them very point. They had to go and get a spot of Pepsi, they just feel welcome, and they bought it the room. And they didn't just drink, and they didn't drink out of themselves either. They just gave to us. And it's amazing. We took pictures, pictures. In the Swedes, my boss, you know, even shy to take that. You know, the fierce pride and dignity of who they are. And one I think was his cousin, who got a cousin's aunt staying there as well in the other rooms. And she said she wanted to be a doctor. It's not fair play, is it? But she's going to one of the schools where I'm going to London. She's coming from the slums. You know? I think it's amazing the way that they have so little. That they were so friendly, and they were immaculate, they were clean, and their brand new clothes. It was like the lads were getting ready to go out for a night out, or a pub or something. You know, and they were wearing jeans in the heat. So it's kind of hard to describe what was happening. It was just it's just amazing. You know, you hear them saying amazing, brilliant, but you kind of have to be. See it with your own eyes.
About halfway over the bridge, we encountered a man sitting with his child. He was kind of separated from everyone else. Other beggars, they're a bit to the side, and people selling food and jewellery, other goods, they're fairly far away from him too. And he was fairly bedraggled, like his clothes were torn, dirty. He was holding a child, and the child, it was awful, like, he was starving, malnourished. The father himself was seriously in no good condition. Even for an Asian, he was fairly pale, like, it was as if the bone was coming through. It was an odd thing to see. Normally you see the women begging with their children, as if they have nowhere else to go, but this is a man as if he had been deserted, which in the Asian culture is just completely unnatural. My heart went out to him, it really did. He had nothing, like he was hardly begging at all, but more wailing softly to himself. The child really had nowhere to go. I couldn't see the child surviving much longer, or the father for that matter. It was horrific, really, to sum it up in one word. I've never seen such a sight, to be honest. It'll stay with me for the rest of my life, no question. But at the stage he was at, I don't think there was any way of helping him. He was really the lowest of the low, as far as I've seen. He could do nothing with the rest of his life. From my perspective, anyway, I thought it was terrible how he was being passed out by the thousands of people on our bridge, but really, like, I don't know what he expected, you know. There were so many beggars, but I really, my heart went out when I saw the child. Like, there was nothing he can do for that child, there was nothing he could do for himself. He was really a lost cause. It's a terrible thing to say, but it frightened me that such a thing could exist. In appearance, he was very different from other beggars in the street. Like, the Asian people as a whole, homeless or in the lap of luxury, they all present themselves very well. But this man, his hair was long, very, very dirty. His skin was just infested. It was really covered in insects, really, is the word, I suppose. Child was, I don't even know if the child was alive, really. It was a tough thing to see, but I'm not too sure how to put it in words.
You might be thinking, like, but it's actually really difficult for the lads here to talk about the experiences we've had. I mean, the poverty in this country is just something else. You can see, you can read any geography book and you can see pictures and pastures on the poor in the third world, but you won't actually know what it's about until you come and experience it. So I think it's very brave of the lads to say their experiences here. So that's about all we have to say here now. To the area and talked about the causes, cures and symptoms of leprosy. He then gave us a guided tour of the area, taking us through the work areas where the patients work, the nursery, the garden, and also showed us the community at the back of the centre. Now Sam is going to talk about his experience.
As part of the tour we visited a nursery
in the rehabilitation centre. These kids did not have leprosy, but were children of people with leprosy. It was great to interact with the kids, as this was the first time we actually met kids on the trip so far, and I was looking forward to that myself a lot. They were delighted to meet us and play with us, although we only got to play with them for a few minutes. But as soon as we went in, they started singing and dancing, and they were really excited. And it was kind of hard to say goodbye because we only got about 10 or 15 minutes with them. As for the wards, we visited some of them after the nursery. At the start, I was a bit apprehensive to meet and greet some of the patients because I didn't know what to expect. Once I shook one or two of the hands of the patients, things kind of got going, and it was easy to salute them and talk to them. We greeted them with Namaste, which means how are you. It was just a friendly greeting to the strangers. As for the women, we didn't shake their hands. We just bowed to them as a sign of respect. The women are they're still very colourful and vibrant, and were delighted to see us. It was a good experience overall, in my opinion. Brian, what's up to?
I suppose what I can tell you about is we travelled after the wards. We travelled through a garden that the lepers themselves and the staff, the brothers, helped each other build. They plant mainly crops, but the only product they don't plant was rice, which was pretty odd because that seems to be the favourite food over here. But it was great to see when we were passing through that had anyone that wanted or anyone that was suitable to work there was working. People who were missing some limbs or fingers, or just like anyone that wanted to work really could do anything they wanted. It was great to see them all working together, and they all got on. And as we were passing through, there was a lady who was in a wheelchair, who had leprosy in both feet, and her toes her legs were deformed in certain ways, but her duty was to watch a gate that was already locked that she didn't have the key to. But I suppose she felt a sense of importance out of it, and she was using, just getting involved with everyone really. And after the gardens, we travelled through, and we travelled through, which none of us were expecting. There was a community out the back of the gardens, and in the community there was the families of the lepers that were already in, so they could come and go and visit people whenever they wanted, or whoever they wanted to visit. So we met with one or two of the communities, and it's only one single room that they live in, but they were all, yeah, they were all really courteous to us, and they were extremely grateful. That's the word, grateful for just even that one room. There may be two or three people living in there, but sure, they loved it. They had their washing just outside, so they could wash themselves and they could hang up clothes and dry clothes. But we also met a young girl whose name was Teresa, and Brother Prem explained to us that her name was Teresa because she was born the same day that Mother Teresa died. So, I thought that myself that was a great experience, just to see, even though people may have illnesses, that they can still work away as normal people, still be normal members of society, like, well, even their own little community, which was great, which means they ate their own crops as well, and it was really great to see. And how they greeted Brother Prem whenever they saw him was they touch him on both feet, and that was a sign that they were asking for a blessing of him. And anyone that would do it, he'd always give the blessing to them. So it was great to see that they had respect for him, for taking them in and for looking after them. It was a really great experience. So I think Adrian, come back to Adrian now.
Yeah. Just at the start of it as well, I think we were all a bit anxious and nervous about the whole idea of approaching a leper centre. Like, we didn't really know how to deal with it, but as Brother Prem described it, like, first of all, we weren't going to be meeting any people suffering from leprosy suffered from contagious leprosy. But he also talked about how you could contract it, and you'd have to be around them for long periods of time, and it travels through the air. So we were able to touch them and greet them and talk with them all as we would with any person. And we then kind of worked our way through our work area, where we saw patients making sandals and simple things which give them a sense of importance in life and give them a kind of a purpose in life as such. And we saw them making saris, as they call them, for the sisters. It's actually where every sari around the world is produced for the MC sisters, and they took great pride in that. That was a very important thing to them. And they were paid for it as well. So yeah, they practically had employment within the centre itself. It was its own little town as such, nearly. And we also went into the wards as well. I found it quite difficult at the start, but then as you kind of greet the people, you get to see the kind of character behind them, the personality they have. And it was a really special moment, like meeting them all and seeing how important it is to them, just for people to come and meet them and touch them. Like, shows they really enjoyed that aspect of it, like that somebody would come up to them and greet them. Really makes their day, because they're just confined to their bed, their room for the day. And I couldn't help but think, if my grandparents were in that situation, like, how they'd be treated. But it was great to see the facilities available for them, like that people actually dedicate their lives to them and help them in everyday life, feeding them and giving them clothing and really just taking care of them. Another thing Brother Prem was talking to us about actually was in the past, lepers weren't allowed down the main streets in towns. They actually had to travel down the railway lines in the so that's why the leper centre was actually situated beside the railway, where lepers could access it. And that kind of shows a kind of bad side of the Indian culture. But on the other hand, then when you go inside the centre and you see the good side of the Indian culture, in the sense that people are willing to dedicate their lives to the quality of life and improving the quality of life of the lepers themselves. So that was just another aspect of it that I enjoyed. And also, as we made our way down through the garden, it was just incredible to see how well kept it was and maintained. Because with such little tools, like, they were able to grow all the crops. They were completely self-sufficient. And that was just an absolute joy to see. Like, you could really see the work of Christ through the people actually working on site. And they took such pride in it. They were always working away on the crops and maintaining it each and every day, which was very, very good to see. And I really enjoyed the trip on the whole, to be honest.
I thought it was great for, see, the people who used to go there, who were actually rehabilitated, they all have an opportunity to work in the actual centre. So if you go there and you're healed from leprosy, you're basically set for life. You have a job, you know, you have something to do, whether it be helping out in the workers' room, the garden, in the nursery even, teaching, keeping the patients company. Being able to do that is great, because you can relate to the people who are actually being rehabilitated, and it's also a great means of employment for people, people with leprosy who are rejected from their society. Usually they're complete, when someone's found out that they have leprosy, the society and community kind of reject them, and there's no place to go. They discard them, as Adrian says. and they can't find employment. Even if they don't have any physical deformities, once you have leprosy, you're basically an outcast, and it's great to see that they can get work after they're rehabilitated in that centre. I found that really amazing that the brothers provided that work for me.
Well, on myself now, the wards was probably the main thing that hit me, because I myself now, like, I have fierce trouble with people like that have illnesses or even the way the deformities. So in a sense that I myself achieved I got a great achievement from the day, because I don't know what it was, but since I've been young that I've always had fear really of people that had deformities, that I just think myself that why should anyone suffer from it, like, and I've always been afraid to even interact with them. But because of this trip itself, that I suppose I've overcome one fear anyway for definite, because I'd say now I'd be able to talk away and shake hands and have genuine conversations with anyone, really. I'll be honest, when we went into the wards, that it was, I found it fairly crazy, like, that it really kind of creeped me out, like, yeah, crazy, but creeped me out, like, but I suppose after the first one or two handshakes, you see, geez, these people are genuine people, like, so why not just get along and, I suppose, have fun, like. And I suppose every time you shook their hands, most of them put your hand in their head. I have no idea what that means, but it felt good, like, that they were really just happy to see us, really. And even the women themselves, when we were told, like, not to shake hands with them, just to bow. I mean, even a bow and a namaste, like, was great for them. They loved it. But yeah, I suppose that's the development that I got out of myself, like this. If not, I can achieve that. Or conquer my own fears, really.
Yeah, just on the nursery as well, actually, I found it very surprising to see how welcoming they were. Like, if you stepped into a classroom at home, they'd kind of be all fairly, like, apprehensive. Yeah, who's this person coming into our classroom? But the minute we entered into the nursery, they were just jumping up and down and screaming at us. And they started performing and singing for us and dancing and everything. Just an absolute pleasure to see how welcomed we were into their centre. And they were very inquisitive about the cameras as well when we took them out to take a few pictures of us with them, playing with them, doing the aeroplane and giving them little toys and things like that. Yeah, just even something as simple as just tickling them, like, they just take so much pleasure out of it, and it's great to just put a smile on a child's face. Like, there's nothing more fulfilling, and it's just really great to see that and experience that firsthand. And yeah, that was just another thing I thought I'd add in.
Yeah, I think I could say something about the nursery. When I went into the nursery, I was expecting most of those kids to have leprosy themselves. But when we found out that they were, like, children of lepers, and they were perfectly normal, I suppose I wasn't really afraid to interact, because, I mean, even their lovely lady, there was many of them just. There was one fella that really kind of caught my eye, that he wouldn't be messing or playing with the other children, but he'd come over, just give a little tip on his shoulder, ask her to take a picture of him. Just playing out, he'd look at the picture, he'd smile and say thank you and walk away. And that was shocking for me, because the rest of the kids were jumping on each other for pictures. Like, just nothing I noticed, like, but it was great, just because they were in school at the time, like, they were in middle class, I suppose. I think you're going to read something from the Bible.
In closing, we're going to finish with an extract from the Bible. In the parable of the 10 lepers, one leper returned to thank Jesus. Throughout our Indian immersion visit, we have seen how thankful they are, especially for those who care for them, such as the presentation brothers. That's all.
That's all, folks.
Bye. Bye. Bye.
go around and eat it.
Was the smell. It was like walking through
like a rugby club or something with the smell of deep heat or the smell of disinfectant. It was the first thing that hit me before I saw any of the beds. Then walking in, I saw it was a lot bigger than I expected, and the men were separated from the women, and it was like two big shapes going off like that way. But I wasn't really fazed when I first went in there seeing the people, because they looked comfortable and happy enough with the conditions that they were even considering on, which I think was one of the main aims of the Mother Teresa to set up the place.
Unlike the two lads, when I walked in, first of all, I was pretty terrified. There was just when you walk, then before you even come in the door, there's bodies on the street just outside, and I'd never saw anything like that before in my life. And then when we actually walked in, there was just the minute you go in the door, there's beds right in front of you, and there's just people lying on, just lying there dying. Which I found really hard to put together. I saw it, like Darren said, there was a guy there now that you quick glance, when we walked in, like a quick glance around the room, and I just saw a lot of bodies. But there was one man there with a skin pigmentation, and he's got white, and his eyes, was buried. He was a terrifying guy. He looked like something out of a horror movie. And I was terrified of him. That really set the mood for me, because I was going to shake and go in there at the start then. So that's really what I felt when I first saw it.
One of the things that I took from the day was the work the volunteers do. We went with Jim McGuinness, he's an Australian man who's lived most of his life here. He works there every day of the week. He's given up his life to these people. Just to see the compassion he worked with, the way he worked with them, how caring he was for them. He's a hero, really. He's like a living saint. He's an old man, but he still keeps himself going. He treats people, the respect to treat people is unbelievable. How he dealt with people. And he's always upbeat as well. There were also a few volunteers, European volunteers. There's a man from Malta. He was there a couple of months, and he was working in Cali every day, cooking, cleaning, feeding all those great jobs. There were a couple from Italy. They were also there for a couple of months, and they were giving up their time. There was a young lad from America somewhere. He'd been there a few weeks, and just the way they conducted themselves, they were exciting the place. They knew exactly what to do with people. They had no hesitancy or anything when they saw someone hand out for food, or you know, someone in pain. They knew how to deal with it. I thought it was brilliant that they'd given up their time just to make these people's lives better. Afterwards, they brought us upstairs, they gave us some tea, and kind of messing and chatting away. They're normal people, down-to-earth people, just giving up their time, giving up their lives for a few months to try and do their bit for these people.
One of the things that I did when I was in there was when we started the feeding, and we brought around the food and the plates and left them beside the beds for people who could feed themselves. Now there was one man that I was with who I had to feed him because he couldn't sit up, and he could barely swallow because there was something wrong with his throat, so he couldn't talk and he couldn't eat basically. So at the start I just sat down in his bed, and one of the other volunteers gave me a spoon, but whatever way he was trying to eat, the spoon wasn't really working, so I started feeding him with my hands, breaking up pieces of chicken with rice and whatever curry sauce was in it, and he was just lying there in front of me, and I think he was half blind as well, so he couldn't really see when the food was coming towards him, so I kind of had to tap him on the side of his mouth, and his mouth would just open for the food, and I'd have to put it back to the back of his throat so he could swallow it, and every few times I gave him a bit of food, I'd have to finish it up with water. And it took a good long while to eat very little food, and I held his hand with my other hand while I was feeding him, and I think just the sensation of being touched by somebody else, he just grasped my hand so tight at the time he felt me near him. And after I finished feeding him, I decided to sit down on the floor and get to his level, and I don't know if he could see me or not, but so I was face to face with him, and since he couldn't talk, I kind of felt bad that I couldn't communicate with him. So I kind of started to think to myself what was the one way that I could communicate with him, and I started singing to his ear slowly, like, and I just saw this expression on his face, just this bright expression of happiness. Even though he didn't know the words that I was singing, he didn't know what it meant, he could just hear it, and it just rested him after, like, going through all the stuff that he's ever gone through, you know? It was basically it.
Yeah, I was very lucky in the fact that, I was very scared going in, and when we started to interact with the patients, who they actually put me with was a young enough guy named Israel, who was down the very back of the room, and he was in his 30s, I'd say, and I couldn't believe the scene there. I was expecting, because what we even saw before that was we're very old, we were in 60s, 70s up there, and he was only in his 30s, but he was telling me that he fell off the back of a truck and he crushed his spine and was just basically grounded into dust. And he had been married and had a child, but he lost all of his job, everything. And he'd ended up there, and I was gobsmacked by that. But the thing about him was, even though he was bedbound, he was lying on his front, he couldn't turn around, he would be able to go to the bathroom himself. He'd bring a bottle down with him. And like, the thing about him was, even though he'd lost all that and he was in that place, he still was just such a happy guy. He had a radio, I remember, and he was playing music out of it, and I kind of started saying, oh, baiting out the tunes, you know, messing around with him. And he said, yeah, yeah, and I just kind of started dancing like that, and he just moved his upper body dancing, but he was smiling and laughing at that. And I just thought it was great for him, because he was just waiting. He said even himself he was waiting for death, because he can't do anything else for his life. But it's just fantastic for him that he can spend his last few years, months, and weeks in a place like that where they care for him, and they just make them happy instead of them being out in the street, just a rotting corpse, people walking past them. So I just thought even. There was great joy inside the place, even though maybe our hope was lost.
So yeah, what he said there about the joy, the way people worked inside, they're saying about the volunteers, how it worked. When we went in first, we didn't go straight into the patients, we went into the back, and we had to clean bed sheets, clothes, that kind of stuff. And it's just the way we saw all the lads working, we saw all the lads working together. Jim was there, I understand as well. Just to see the way everything worked together, I thought it was good bit of development in the way together, the way we worked. There was some massive sheets we had to go through, was to carry them, they were wet, because they were so big, to carry so much water. We had someone, say, cleaning them with some kind of disinfectant, then you'd have to move them all out to someone who rinsed them. Then someone would have to dry them, then someone would have to hang up on the line. That's when we did first kind of ease us into the whole thing. Then we went out and we had to work with the patients themselves. Everyone thought it was brilliant the way I wanted to be last to go out, so I saw everyone out there, and just to see them all sitting down, just no inhibitions, all inhibitions were lost. Just sat down, chatting away with anyone, even if they didn't understand English, and just talking away with them. It just not along to what they were saying. They were happy for you to be there, for you to be listening to them. Just a bit of human contact, a bit of human communication. One of the men I was speaking to, he didn't have a word of English, but I sat next to him, and I knew he was telling me his story. I didn't have a clue what he was saying, but I knew he was telling me his story. And he also helped out, there was a man sitting next to him who didn't have any English, and he seemed seemed like he couldn't talk because he was trying to make signs, but he kind of helped me to understand what the other man was asking for. Then at the dinner time, we were working together. We had to bring out all the plates, bring out the food, the drinks to both sides of the home, to the men and women. There's 101 people there, so it took a while. But again, we all worked together, we all dish out the food. And again, afterwards, we'd collect the cleanup. And as Owen said, he had to feed some of us had to feed some of the patients who weren't able to do it for themselves. And then again, the volunteers were amazing. They were so hospitable to us as well as to the patients. Afterwards, when we went upstairs, it was just nice to see that everyone worked together, and then they were able to, because we worked together, we were able to sit around together and have a bit of a laugh and just have a chat. And I thought that was just one of the best things I got out of the world today.
I think being there, we learned a lot about ourselves, and one of the main things that I learned about myself is communication wise, because there was so many. When we first went in the door, his name was Shishrai, and he was sitting beside this man who couldn't speak, could barely talk, barely move. His name is Benoit, and they were kind of a pair in the corner trying to look after each other. And I think one of the things that we got from being there was we all learned something new about ourselves. For me, I kind of picked up on the communication thing. I mean, to be able to go in there and communicate with people who are in that situation, who some of them had English, some of them didn't, some of them couldn't even talk. It was such a great experience. And there was these two men over in the corner, Shishrai and Benoit. Benoit could barely talk, he could barely sit up, but the two of them were like a pair. Shishrai would always look after him, and he'd always look after Shishrai. And Shishrai, he had a good bit of English, and he was there telling him his name, where he lives, how old he was, and why he was in the place. And it definitely struck me as one of the best things about the place. That we got to communicate with people like them and learn more about themselves, you know?
I'd say what we all kind of, I was surprised by it, I don't know if the lads were, but we all kind of broke down barriers when we were there, like the communication barrier, or just even going in there and getting involved. I thought I would be able to do that. I didn't think I'd be able to interact with patients. But I did, and I was really happy with myself over that. There was this one old man with no English, and Jim had told us before that they even just touched them. They love to be touched. It gives them great satisfaction, just the personal interaction and feeling. And so he was telling us as well to rub their kind of heads, yes. Which I thought was a bit weird. It was like petting a dog or something, I thought. Which I didn't think you'd do. But there was one guy, and there was a very awkward silence between us anyway, and I didn't know what to do. He wasn't really responding to me. So I just began to rub his head, and he began to smile, and I was there for only 5 minutes just going to rub his head and hold his hand, which he was smiling, and he started talking to me then. And I had no idea what he was saying, and I was getting out of the way, he was smiling at him, and he just talked for a good 10 minutes to me about, I don't know what really, but it was good. It was great personal development for me to be able to get stuck in with people like that. So I thought that was a great, great part.
Such good students, and we hope you have.
Thank you.
Thanks, lads, to all the students.
Give them a clap.
Hey.
Good morning. For us it's 9:30 in the morning and I'm Brother Cyril Christopher, a Christian brother, the community leader in this house. This is St. Joseph's College, Beaubassin. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I joined the brothers at the age of 13 and a half. And did I know what I was joining? No. The group of men? No. But over the years, there was something in them that attracted me. And now I began to focus on what the Christian Brothers was all about. I think it took me 40 years before I got a bit of sense. And I realized that in many ways, I was confined within the four walls of a classroom. And that's where I had been all these years. Now, I happen to be on the province leadership team since 96. And it's since then that my eyes were opened. What were they opened to? That out there is a world that I know so little about. Those that have nothing. And here was I teaching a bunch of boys that had everything. So while I was moving around our schools, being on the team, I tried to get our communities, our schools involved in something greater, a larger God. Was it tough going? Very. Because we were in a comfort zone in our schools. and it's so hard to get anyone to move. And then the turning point for me came in 2002, when I was asked to be principal of probably our largest school in the world, St. Columba's, that's in New Delhi. And I said to myself, Cyril, now you put your money where your mouth is. And I started realizing that it was so difficult for me to be principal and to be involved in the poor. And I was doing none of that. What we were doing was just a band-aid. So we had afternoon classes for the children of the slums, the ones sleeping on the street. And when I asked them one day, I said, look, what would you like me to do for you? They said, take us for swims. St. Columba's has a beautiful swimming pool. I took them for swims. I dived in myself into the pool. And that's when I took my plunge. I was converted. I was now one with these kids. They welcomed me in their midst. They take me to their homes, tell me about their problems at home. Dad was on the drink, or he was beating up the family. The first opportunity I got was meeting the mother of one of these children, and she used to bleed profusely from the mouth. She had TB, and it was only getting worse. So, what happened then was I had to work. We got in a medical team. We started working with these people, and now doctors started coming into the slums and working with them. Through a priest who was very involved with the people on the street, I opened the doors of St. Columba's to the homeless. Now these were street people, street smart, and thugs in many ways. Having opened our doors to them, there were 700 of them staying in the school. They'd come in late evening, leave early morning. Yes, the school would be a mess. They'd break in occasionally into classrooms and empty them out onto the office as they did mine. But I also realized that we had far too much in our schools. When they broke in a second time, there was nothing for them to steal, and they left it as it was. That was a great learning for me. My spirituality changed. Then we felt we needed to do something we were about 31 lepers staying at our school gate. So we opened the doors of the school to them, and we got hot water in for them to have to bathe, especially in winter. They do their cooking in school, and they follow the similar routine where they come in at about 4 in the evening, leave by about 6 the following morning. And they'd leave the school spotless. Has it changed me? Very much so. That happened in Delhi. I'm now in Calcutta. And we have kids. We have the kids in St. George's and Ashirvad. They're two institutions as part of a larger institution called St. Joseph's. St. Joseph's is a school like any of our other schools. The children pay. But in St. George's and Ashirvad, the children, it's a free school. They're both free schools. Very often the kids come to school hungry. So when they come in, we give them a snack. And about 2 hours later, we give them a full meal, a midday meal. Are these kids hungry? Very much so. Do they have anything? In large measure, out of the 500 children that we have, I would say maybe 10 or 15 are a little better off. The others are staying mainly on the street. all they have is they're up against our school wall, and they have a tarpaulin, a plastic sheet nailed to that wall with two sticks, and that's what holds it up. When it rains, that's their only shelter. All the clothes they have are there, up against the wall. There might be 4 and 5 and 6 children in a family. And there's always a smile on their faces, as the teachers will show you. The kids have beatific smiles. You'd never know that they were hungry. You'd never know they were so poor. For those that cannot afford slippers or shoes, we provide them. For those that cannot afford uniforms, we provide them. But to give them a sense of dignity, we try and let them fend for themselves. So even if a mother says, I can't pay for my children's uniform now, I'll only be ready in 2 months. We say, right, in 2 months' time you do it. Otherwise we have the giving attitude, and it doesn't help them. Because after that they all feel that they have to get. The minute they see a foreigner, they've got to take. So that's what we're trying to promote in schools like ours, giving our children an awareness of themselves, a sense of dignity, and really letting them live life to the full. Thank you so much. God bless you.
There's more than meets the eye, more strange, more beautiful than these words can describe. Don't know how I got here, the past has come and gone. Must be angels in the room tonight. So much here in this world I'll never understand. Must be angels in the room, oh, tonight. must be angels in the room. Oh, can you feel it too? Must be angels in the room.
Brother from Limerick. I've spent 53 years altogether in India, and I was delighted to see the group of boys from Ardscoil Rís here with us. I'm quite sure that they will have learned many things during their brief visit to West Bengal. It is inevitable that people visiting a strange country will learn. During the course of my life here in India, I have learned enormously from the people of India. When I came to India, the world was round, and it took us 2 weeks to get from Ireland to Bombay, and then from Bombay another 2 nights in a train to Kolkata. In those days I was confused. Meeting the crowds in the streets of Calcutta, I said, what is to be done for these people? Fortunately, I was put in teaching very soon after my arrival, and I began to know the people of India. And I soon learned that I was going to receive more than I was going to give. They were a welcoming people, always friendly, always helpful. I began to appreciate their spirituality, their acceptance, children in school, receptive, respectful, always cooperative. And today, after more than 50 years in India, I am still learning. There's never an end to it. And today I've made some wonderful discoveries, particularly from a group of children who are living within our compound here. They belong to Larsh. FMR India, Fellowship with Mentally Retarded in India. Interacting with those children, meeting with them, you learn very quickly that you don't come to give them, you come to receive from them. And what you receive may not be material, but it is a deep spiritual intimacy that is beyond all value. So my life has been a life of learning, learning, learning. Initially, I thought I was going to teach, but I've learned that you receive much more when you give.